Climate of the Nation report for 2018, released today by the Australia Institute, shows that concern about climate-related issues are a five-year high. That's despite continuing division in Canberra about the best way to tackle the issue. John Hewson is a former leader of the Federal Liberal Party and he launched this report today. I spoke with him earlier. John Hewson, welcome to Matter of Fact.
Thanks very much, Jeremy. Pleasure to be here.
Now, all the hand-wringing in Parliament over the past few years about things like carbon pricing, the Paris Agreement, the National Energy Guarantee would suggest that the politicians in Parliament representing the people are fairly divided in their attitudes about climate change. And yet this survey that you've launched today tells quite a different story. How is it that there's this discrepancy?
Well, the community is and has always been, I think, way ahead of the political process in terms of recognising the significance of the challenge of climate change and expecting governments to respond. And when you get over 70% of the community saying that sort of thing and understanding that it links to things like the drought and crop production and bushfires and impact on the reef and so on, I mean, they don't take a lot of convincing that something needs to be done. And the thing that staggers me as an ex-politician is, gosh, if you get 50% of the people saying this is a good idea, you should do it, you'd normally grab it and run with it, right? You'd say, you know, we don't get that sort of support. If I got 50% in 93, I would have won, you know. And when you're getting 70+% in these sort of surveys and higher numbers perhaps in support of things like renewables, I'm staggered that the politicians do not listen. They've just absorbed in this short-term game-playing, point-scoring, blame-shifting that they do on issues like this. And the bottom line is households and businesses are struggling with increased electricity prices, increased gas prices.
One of the things this survey doesn't do is address climate change in relation to other issues that people care about. So we know from previous studies elsewhere that climate and the environment take a backseat to things like jobs, the economy, the state of the economy, incomes. What is your sense about where climate sits in relation to those other issues, the more day-to-day concerns?
Well, I think obviously day-to-day concerns today are dominating, and the cost of living, broadly defined, is a major issue, the major issue, particularly in a world where wages have been so flat for as long as they have. And as we've seen in the recent national accounts numbers, although consumer spending was OK, I mean, it was basically funded by people running down their savings and increasing their debts, and we already have the highest level of household debt in the world, in those circumstances, you know, they're struggling to meet those day-to-day costs of living. So they do expect governments to focus on solving some of those problems, do something about housing affordability, something about electricity and gas prices, something about childcare, something about school fees, whatever it is. And, you know, in relation to that, though, there are dimensions of that that are important. And I think looking at electricity prices, they make the link in their minds between the need to respond to climate and the need to get electricity prices down. And I guess in that sense, that's how I'd fit this survey in context.
One of the difficulties in addressing those concerns is the timeline to which we shift away from coal. I mean, people have different views on how soon that should happen, how that should happen. Are some of those outlooks realistic?
Well, I mean, this survey shows that it's better than 60% of people want just to move away from coal-fired power in the next 20 years. They're accepting it's a long-term transition. I mean, what most people are looking for is some leadership on this, for governments to set out a path, a transition path, away from coal and other fossil fuels towards renewables, not at a chaotic pace, at a measured pace. You know, the interesting thing is that households themselves have moved way ahead of this. The penetration of household solar, for example, on household roofs is per capita the highest in the world. And so the community's responded in its own way to these challenges. I can't understand why government's making it so hard.
It was an interesting figure that 30% of respondents in this survey said that the market and energy companies should be the ones to decide when old coal plants are shut down. And you're a doctor of economics. What is the capacity of the market, people's decision-making, to drive some of these changes?
Well, you've seen in most coal-fired power stations have got an identified effective life, if you like, and most that's pretty well known, and that you can schedule these over a period of time. But when we said the recent example, for example, the closure by AGL of the Liddell coal plant in 2022, coal-fired power in 2022, I mean, there was a debate by the government trying to pressure AGL to keep it open. AGL said, look, it's not commercially viable to keep it open. and it contributes about 1,000 megawatts of power. We can find 1,000 megawatts of power in a lot less time than 5 years from the renewable sector, so we can do it at a lower cost with less, you know, near zero emissions. Why would we try and keep Liddell open? So the market worked there. The price signals were there. AGL responded accordingly. It was only the government coming in over the top saying, hang on, we can do better than that. You know, for some other reason than sensible commercial viability, to say, well, you've got to keep it open. You know, trying to satisfy half a dozen people within the government, within the Liberal Party, I guess.
Where do country voters, National Party constituents, sit on this issue in relation to where they were a year ago?
Well, I think it's interesting in terms of the numbers. I mean, only 15% of national voters do not think climate change is occurring, which is down from 29% last year.
That's halved
year. And, of course, in One Nation, it's 45% of One Nation voters agree the seriousness of climate change is exaggerated, and that's down from 56%. So they are moving in favour of recognising the significance of climate change in two constituencies which many people would have thought, you know, weren't prepared to acknowledge anything in that respect.
How powerful is the coal lobby? Are politicians being influenced by corporate interests into acting against the national interest?
Well, there's no doubt that some politicians respond to coal and they maybe reflect the interests of their coal constituency. But, look, I think most people have accepted globally that the transition from coal-fired power to renewables is an inevitable process. If you're taking climate change seriously, that's where you've got to go. And what they're expecting governments to do is provide a bit of leadership in putting a map, you know, roadmap of how that might be achieved over time, given some level of certainty against which the corporate sector can make its decisions, and in particular its investment decisions, in new sources of energy.
Now, you're forecasting this issue of climate to be a factor in the Wentworth by-election. Mm. How do you think that's going to play out? We understand the pre-selection is being confirmed tomorrow for the Liberal Party. How is this going to play out longer term?
Well, having been the member for Wentworth, I know how tough a seat that can be. It can be quite a fickle seat. I would never have taken it for granted, and I don't think anybody should, even though the margin that Malcolm's left there is quite large. I mean, I see two things happening. One, you'll get a substantial, I think, protest vote against the Liberal Party, probably against both major parties, but more on the Liberal Party for the leadership machinations of the last few weeks. And then secondly, it is a seat where climate issues are important, where environment issues are important. I remember a lot of those constituents would have taken credit, for example, of the closure of the Franklin Dam back in the early 80s under the Hawke government. I mean, they saw themselves as environmental activists. And so don't underestimate the significance of those sorts of issues. And it may be that this becomes a bit of a totemic issue in terms of the Wentworth by-election, not just the anti-government vote, if you like, but also the significance of the climate challenge.
Right, John Hewson, good to have you on the program. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Jeremy. It's a pleasure.